Michael from Red Chair Diaries here in Nova Scotia, Canada. I wanted to reply to Kenneth's video on Excalibur. Let me see. Mr. Carr Productions Life. Ken, you have way too many names, I think, on the net. I get confused. So you published this the 26th, so that's today, I take it. Yeah, okay. Anyway, I just want to say that Excalibur and the Arthurian myths are some of my favorite literary and cinematic experiences. I love this movie Excalibur. I actually have the Laserdisc, so got that, I don't know, mid-80s, late-80s. But it's panned and scanned, so I'm still on the lookout to get a widescreen Blu-ray. Which I've seen a few times in stores, and I didn't get it and at that price, and then it disappeared. So at some point I'll pick it up. It'll be on a $10 bin or something like that. Yes, I do love this movie. I believe the director is John Borman. I'm doing this from memory. I've probably have seen the movie three or four times, maybe even five, but I haven't seen it for quite a long time, for well over a decade. And I do want to see it again. You were talking about one of the, I think, Arthur's son. I'm doing it from memory. I think that was played by Charlie Borum, who is the son of the director and also a lifelong pal of Ewan McGregor's. And they have done, they did a series or a documentary about, either a series on TV or a documentary, I believe, about their motorcycle ride around the world, something like that. So they're pals that do a lot of stuff. And Charlie Borum, I don't think is a real gifted actor from what I've seen. But then again, I've only seen him as a young person because he was also in his father's movie called The Emerald Forest, I believe. I think he was kidnapped by the pygmies or something somewhere in the Amazon. That is an interesting movie. Not one I want to see too often, but that's something you might want to check out, The Emerald Forest. Helen Mirren, of course, was wonderful. I always get mixed up on the names for the Arthurian legends. You know, like there's Morgaine, I think, or Morgana and Morgana, and there's Mordred. I get them all mixed up. But she's wonderful. But if you think about the themes of the movie, they're what you call archetypes, and they resonate throughout different myths. And one of the things that comes up in these things is always this sordid inbreeding sort of thing. You know, like somebody has lain with his sister, or somebody has, a man has lain with his mother, or things like this, you know, and there's all of that sort of wizardry and they're confused about it. But just like in the real world, nothing good comes of incest, and this is always something that happens. And I sometimes wonder if these things were actually developed in part to ward people off from these events, you know, from this sordid behavior. I mean, even Cleopatra and her brother, they were married, you know, so. And I think the result of incest. So it goes on and on. Patrick Stewart, you mentioned, yes, he was good in this. He's always good in that sort of role. The cinematography is exquisite. The music is very rousing. I don't have a list of credits in front of me, so I don't remember who did these things. But I really, I just always remembered how much I enjoyed this version of the legends. And I've seen many versions. I probably watched that one with Sam Neill that you were talking about. The one I could not get into is the one that's just, I think, ending this year. The teenage or early 20s Merlin. Couldn't get into that one. Though I did like the series Camelot. And I was sorry that that ended after 1 year. It didn't have enough viewers because I thought that was entertaining. and that really had the big emphasis on the sister Morgana, I think is her name. Nigel Terry, like you say, is wonderful in this. It's a wonderful adventure story. Where you talked about or the ending of it, yes, I thought the final act got a bit dreary. The thing about the Holy Grail part, that maybe they just tried to put too much into it, the knight with the gold face and all of that. But the other thing that you didn't mention is, have you read any of the books, the different adaptations, like the essential one? And I think it's almost 1,000 pages. I know I read it when I was in, like, I don't know if it was grade 9 or grade 12 or something, but I know I was in high school, so it's 40 years ago that I read the book. The Once and Future King by T.H. White, a very, very famous book, and it is the basis for the musical Camelot. And in this one, I think Merlin, I think his life is going backwards or something, where he's older and he's getting younger as the book goes on. I'm trying to remember. I probably have the book here somewhere. And then there was another sequel to it that was found in his papers years after he died, T.H. White, that I don't know if I got or I don't remember if I read it, but I think I have it. And the other series that I really liked by Mary Stewart, there's a trilogy, and the first two were published quite close together in the 1960s, and then the last one was called The Last Enchantment, and I don't think that came out till 1979. So there's the Crystal Cave, I think was the first one. The second one was The Hollow Hills. I read those two. And then The Last Enchantment. And I don't think I ever finished The Last Enchantment. So that's Mary Stewart, spelled like my name, Stewart. And those are wonderful reads. You might want to check those out at the library. They might, I don't know if they're really around a lot now. I guess they're kind of aging out. But those are wonderful books. And the name of the source, the original source material for the Arthurian legends, it's French, and I know that in French is not something that's taught a lot in the States. I think it's pronounced something close to "Le Mort d'Arthur," and which means the death of Arthur. There isn't an accent on the last E. It's silent, I think. And very few of us have ever read that source material by Thomas Malory. It's just so stilted and old-fashioned, and it's really for scholars, I think, more than anything. It's the popular interpretations that people like Mary Stewart have done that is where we get our actual information about the myths. But I've never read the source material, but I have watched a lot of documentaries where people are trying to find King Arthur's Britain. Been a lot of nonfiction books about this sort of thing, and I've looked into these things and articles. So it's something that I really, really enjoy. I really enjoy the King Arthur, the myth. Guinevere, King Arthur, Lancelot. And when you start parsing their names and looking into the roots of where these words have come from, it's fascinating. I don't remember all of it, but I know that things like Guinevere and Lancelot, they actually have meanings. Lance, of course, is like a sword or a spear. And I don't remember the rest of it, like the Elot part of Lancelot. But a lot of it is from the French. Guinevere is a French name, I believe. Arthur is the French version of Arthur. So it's in the old days, the French and the English were all very, very much mixed in England, because it was not in the English England in those days. It was probably, I don't know if it was Brittany or Normandy, Brittany, I imagine, something like that. Whatever. Anyway, glad to see your interpretation of this movie, and I just wanted to give you that little bit of publicity, and my comments on it, and I will upload this and see what happens. Anyway, thanks a lot, and we'll see you around the tube.